Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you and we praise you for your word. Your word is the truth, and we receive this word written in our heart, written in our mind, and we thank you for the word that we take hold of and do it. It will bring forth much fruit, and we thank you that you're establishing in the truth regarding this subject. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated if you would. We're sharing with you on the subject of God's covenant of prosperity. And when most people teach on the subject of prosperity, they're teaching strictly about financial things, all about finances and give and get and all these kind of things. But that's not what the word brings forth. It does bring forth about financial things, but that's really not what God's prosperity is all about, as we have seen already. In 3 John verse 2, "Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper." What's the word prosper mean? Just to have financial blessings? No. It's talking about having a good journey. Having a good journey, being successful, that it will be well with you on your way, essentially. As you, the root word is means you're walking in a way, and EU means well, well on your way. So it's going to be well with you in all aspects of life. And he says, and be in health, even as thy soul prospereth. That means your overall prosperity and health is in proportion to the prosperity of your soul. That means we've got to see things happen in the area of our soul in order to see the prosperity and the health come forth in our life. So, as your soul, which is made up of your will, your intellect, and emotions, as it's prospering, then you're going to see the overall prosperity will come forth in all these other areas. And we've mentioned the fact that prosperity begins spiritually. When you come into relationship with the Lord by receiving Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, it continues as you receive the Holy Spirit to come and dwell in you, which is received after you're born again. And that continues through the working of the Word of God, as God's Word, which is spiritual law, is coming to you, being written in your heart, written in your mind, bringing the revelation of Jesus Christ in His ways, bringing the knowledge of God that you take hold of and act upon in your life. So it's spiritually, it's going to carry over into soul realm prosperity, as we see, as our minds renewed to think on His ways. We choose the way of the Lord. We govern our emotions and make sure that we're yielding ourselves unto the Lord. It carries over in the area of our health, where in our physical body, where we get healed, we're strong and having a good journey physically. Also in the area of relationships, God wants us to have good relationships. He wants us to not have any problems, strife, arguments, negative things. Doesn't want us to have bitterness, resentments, unforgiveness, anger, all these things. He doesn't want us to be having problems in relating to people. He wants good relationships, and He will accomplish that in His prosperity. Also in ministry and in our spiritual warfare as we're going forth in ministry and the gifts of the Spirit, many things that show the prosperity of God. We've looked at a lot of scriptures that have shown all aspects of the prosperity of God in all these ways. And then, of course, also, it covers the area of finances as well. But primarily, God's prosperity is not just talking about finances. It's talking about the overall work of the Lord in your life to bring forth what He purposes so that it will be well with you as you are walking out, carrying out the things that God wants. We covered many principles from the Old Testament primarily, and we've got some more we'll pick up as we go, but we're going to talk about New Testament principles. Because if you are going to prosper and you're going to be successful and blessed, you're going to have riches, you're going to have treasure, you're going to have all these blessings and good things that are going to come forth in your life if it's going to be well with you. Well, we need to understand all about this. Matthew 6, verse 19 says, "Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon the earth, where moth and rust is corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal." No, we're not supposed to treasure things up on the earth. What are we supposed to be doing? "But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal." We should be laying up the things, treasures in heaven, which are going to bring forth God's blessings. He says, "For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." And what is God with us according to? According to our heart. He's looking upon the heart. He wants to show Himself strong and manifest Himself to those whose heart is perfect towards Him. Therefore, your heart is so important. And where your treasure is where your heart will be. And when God sees what's in your heart, He is going to then manifest Himself, and He will bring forth His blessings in your life. We see in Matthew chapter 12, over here in verse 35. Matthew 12, verse 35. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. If you are going to prosper, have a good journey as your soul prospers, and you're going to see success and good things go, you have a good journey in life, you've got to get a good treasure, or this word actually means the word thesaurus, which is where you collect and lay things up. You're going to collect and lay good things up in your heart. And then a good man, out of what's in his heart, is going to bring forth good things. So the key is, you need to get good things into your heart, which is going to be the Word of God sown in your heart, bringing the revelation of the things that God has for you. And as you keep this Word in your heart, you then will be a good man walking in the way of the Word, and you're going to bring forth good things out of your life. It's going to come forth. Over in Mark chapter 10, we see in verse 23, Jesus looked around about and He said to His disciples, how hardly, or this hardly means with difficulty, is the Greek word. With difficulty shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God. Now He's talking about earthly riches here. And you and I are to enter into the kingdom of God. You say, well, I thought we were in the kingdom of God. We are positionally, through receiving Jesus' personal Lord and Savior, we've been delivered out of the authority of darkness, translated into His kingdom. But then we are to enter into His kingdom experientially as we walk in the ways of the Word of God and walk in the light of the Word of God. And He says, of course, what's the kingdom we're going to eventually? We're going to be in the millennial kingdom with the Lord Jesus Christ. And we want to, of course, enter into it. And notice He says, with difficulty, those that have riches are going to be able to enter into it. Now, why would they not be able to enter into it? The disciples were astonished at His words. And Jesus answered again and said to them, children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? Now He qualifies us a little bit. There's nothing wrong with riches. It's whether you trust in riches or not. Do riches have you, or are riches and things that God brings to you, things that you use? You never want to let riches have control of you. If you trust in uncertain riches, then you make it an idol in your life, and you will not be able to enter into the kingdom of God. In Luke chapter 12, we pick up in verse 16. Here's where Jesus spoke a parable, and He said to them, the ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentifully. He's producing a lot. He thought within himself, saying, what shall I do, because I have no room where to bestow my fruits? He said, this will I do, I'll pull down my barns, build greater, and they'll bestow all my fruits and my goods. And I'll say to my soul, soul, thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. What's this guy doing? He's living totally to himself. And as he's prospering in what he's producing, of these goods and all these things, he's only thinking about one thing, himself. Remember that God said, it is God who's the one who enables you to get wealth, to establish His covenant with you. It's not you yourself. So this guy's thinking he's done the whole thing himself, and God said to him, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? So he that layeth up treasure for himself, if that's the motivation and the purpose of all we gain for, it says he's not rich towards God. If we want God's prosperity will produce riches. It'll produce blessing. We want God's riches, but treasure for yourself doesn't make you rich before God. That's why we want to be sure we have the riches of God established in us. Because as it says, we're not going to be taking this with us. We want to have the things that are going to carry over in the life to come. So here we want to be sure that we're rich towards God. And he went on and said to his disciples, therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what you shall eat, neither for the body, what you shall put on. The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment. He said, consider the ravens, for they neither sow nor reap, which neither have storehouse nor barn, and God feedeth them. How much more are you better than the fowls? And which of you, with taking thought, can add to a stature one cubit? If you then be not able to do that thing which is least, why take ye thought for the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They toil not, and they spin not. Yet I say unto you that Solomon, all his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. If then God so clothed the grass, which is today in the field, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? God will meet your needs and give you clothing, raiment, and food. Seek not ye what you shall eat or what you shall drink, neither be of doubtful mind. For all these things do the nations of the world seek after, and your Father knoweth that you have need of these things. But rather seek the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. God says not to seek after all these things. Instead, seek after the kingdom of God, and then all these things will be added unto you. As he says, fear not, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Because if we are going to see God manifest himself in his blessing and prosperity and riches to us, we got to seek him. We got to seek the kingdom. Learn how the rule and the reign of God works. Because we're going to use that, learn how the rule and reign of God works. We're going to operate according to it. And as we not only seek the kingdom, in Matthew 6:33 says we seek his righteousness, we're going to see God's blessings come forth. And we're going to get rich toward God. That's what we want. Not rich in things. We want to be rich towards God. We see in Luke chapter 16 and verse 10 something else. Luke 16:10, it says, he that's faithful in that which is least is faithful also in much. He that's unjust in the least, he's unjust also in much. If therefore you've not been faithful in the unrighteous mammon, which is talking about riches, things, who will commit to your trust the true, talking about the true riches? That tells you there is a riches that's of this world, but that's not the true riches. The true riches come from God. And real prosperity with God is seeing the true riches come to you. Where are your treasures to be in the things of God? God wants to commit the true riches to us, but it won't happen if we're not faithful. It says, if you have not been faithful in that which is another man's, who shall give you that which is your own? Well, that tells you something. You got to be faithful in that which is not your own, but somebody else's. Do you treat something that someone might have loaned to you or you borrowed, or even a rental car, which is not your own, do you treat it like your own? Or I don't care, it's not mine, it's no big deal. No, you need to treat everything just as it's your own. If you have been faithful in that which is another man's, who's going to give you that which is your own? Otherwise, God wants us to be faithful and to treat everything, and not just because it's not belonging to me that it's no big deal. No, you should always treat things just like it's your own. He says, no man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, which is riches. Talking about things of this world and money. God wants us to understand that if we're going to see his riches, his blessing, his prosperity, what he purposes for us in our life, then we've got to serve him. We can't be serving money. We can't be serving riches. We can't have our eyes on things, on possessions. We need to get our eyes on the Lord. Of course, what happened? The Pharisees also, who were covetous, heard all these things and they derided him. See, these guys were all out for things. They were covetous. Oh, they loved money and they loved things and they wanted to get all these things for themselves. They weren't trying to be rich towards God. They were trying to be rich towards themselves. It all comes down to the motivation of heart. God's covenant of prosperity is looking upon our heart where our treasure is. He wants to bring forth the true riches to us. And if we will have the true riches, we'll get everything else, including the financial riches and blessings that will bring forth in every area of our life. We need to be sure that we're not covetous. In fact, those people that are covetous, they're in trouble. In Proverbs chapter 21, we see over here in verse 26, it says, He coveteth greedily all the day long, but the righteous give and spare not. We're ready to give out, not spare. Give out, it's going to be given unto you. While the covetous What do? They're greedily. All they're thinking about is how I can get for me, me, me. That's a wrong attitude. In fact, we see those people, as it talks about in Romans chapter 1, that have turned away from the Word of God and didn't want to retain God in their knowledge. God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do the things that are not convenient in Romans 1:28. Verse 29 tells you what they're filled with. They're filled with all these things. These are all works of the flesh, with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, as well as all the rest of these things. All they were is out for themselves, to get. Gimme, gimme, gimme. I want to get for myself. No, we don't want to have those kind of attitudes. Those ones that are loving money or are loving things, and money becomes an idol in their life, they're in trouble. In fact, we even see in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9, it says, I wrote unto you an epistle not to company with fornicators. Those are people that are walking in sexual sin. Yet not altogether with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, extortioners, or with idolaters, for then must you needs go out of this world. He doesn't even want us to be around the covetous. He says, now I've written unto you not to keep company if any man that's called a brother. So this is talking about people of the world, but this also talks about people that are a brother. Some a brother or a sister in the Lord. Brother. Be a fornicator or covetous or idolater or railer or drunkard or extortioner with such a one, we don't want, God doesn't even want you to eat with them. He doesn't want us to be around those kind of people. These are people that are all out for themselves. They're covetous. They want things. That's their whole motivation. They're loving money. That things become their source. What's the result for these guys? 1 Corinthians 6:9 says, the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Be not deceived. All these people, the fornicators, adulterers, effeminate, abusers themselves with mankind, thieves, covetous. The covetous, nor the drunkards, revilers, or extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. They can't. They cannot enter in. That's why we got to be sure. Don't ever let money or possessions or things get a hold of you as a source in your life. No, we're not going to let the enemy have place on those areas. We see the same thing spoken of over in Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 5. In Ephesians 5, we see over here in verse 3. Fornication and all uncleanness or covetousness, not just fornication and uncleanness alone, but covetous as well, let it not be once named among you as become a saint. God doesn't want us to have one time that we're covetous, that we're greedy for money, and we have our eyes totally upon things and serving that. All these things have to be eliminated. He says, you know that no whoremonger, unclean person, or covetous man, who's an idolater, he says he's an idolater, he's got an idol before him, money, hath any inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. You can't have any inheritance whatsoever. Over in Colossians chapter 3 and verse 5, he says this, mortify therefore your members which are upon the earth. You're supposed to mortify all these things. Put them to death, that means. Fornication, uncleanness, nor an affection, evil concupiscence, all these wrong things. But then he also concludes covetousness, which is idolatry. They greed to have more and more. I want more and more. I want more things. I want better and better. All these kind of things. No, this is not a good attitude. God does not want you to have this covetous attitude. It actually is idolatry. God says you are to put this to death. In fact, in 1 Timothy chapter 3, you see over here in verse 1, it talks about someone that had desires and off of a office of a bishop, which is like one who is an overseer. Talks about how he desires a good work, and then it gives qualifications. And here in the list of those, it says not covetous. He can't be someone that's out for money, or that's going to drive him in the way he deals with people. We find there's a lot of people in ministry today that are just totally driven for money. You just look at the way they do things. Their motivation is money in the way they take their offerings. It might take more than one offering, two or three offerings. Why would we take more than one offering? You know, because we didn't get enough money. We want more money. And why are we doing these kind of things? Because we want the money. Their eyes are on the money. That's why they treat certain people certain ways. I know of churches that have refused to let people that are poor sit up in areas that are close where the TV cameras that had TV would see the poor people there, you know, when they were having the camera shots, because they didn't want them to be seen. They only wanted the more well-to-do type people up there, so it brought an image for them. And the rest of them, they stuck them off in another place. You guys sit over here. That's not good. That's doing things with a motivation of looking a certain way. And also, these same ones are the ones that take the 20-minute, 30-minute, 45-minute offerings, or maybe several of them, or whatever, as many as they want, and will do all kinds of things for money. There is a major problem in this. In fact, you can't even be a leader unless you hate covetousness, according to God. In Exodus chapter 18, verse 21, "Moreover, thou shalt provide out of all the people able men," these are ones that were going to be rulers with Moses, "such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness, to place them over such to be rulers," over the thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. They had to hate covetousness, or they weren't even qualified for this. God wants us never to have a covetous attitude in anything that we do in our dealings in ministry. Acts chapter 20, here Paul even spoke about the fact that he didn't have this attitude. He says, "I have coveted no man's silver or gold or apparel." I'm not trying to do anything to try to get something, get people to give such and such or manipulate any of these kinds of ways. And he even speaks about the same attitude again over in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 5. When he says, "Neither at any time used we flattering words, or some flattering discourse, as you know, or a cloak of covetousness," which is God's witness. This cloak of covetousness, this cloak refers to the fact, as the next word below here, where they were showing forth covetous in any way. That shows the fact that we should never be out to try to get something. You know, we've got to be upright, everybody in ministry. I see a lot of people today that they're all into it for the money, and there's a real problem. And we got it to the body of Christ. You can see it on the TV and on the radio. I mean, they're saying, you know, "You've got to give such and such." They care more about keeping their ministry going and just praying that God will just speak to the people. They have to talk to the people and convince them and do what they got to do to try to get them to give. That is not a good thing. You know, and speak all these negative things. Well, if you're overextended. You know, you just draw back and do what you can within your means. But you don't try to manipulate the people. "Well, we don't have enough. We need you to give. We need you to do all these things." People send out these special appeal letters and all these things. That's not the way to do things. This is all shown. Their eyes are on the money, and they're trying to do what they can to manipulate the people to give. God is not pleased with that, and they're not going to be blessed. They're not going to hear a good report. 2 Timothy 3:1 says, "This know also, that in the last days perilous times shall come. Men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous." Yeah, right off the bat here. Covetous. They want for themselves. "Boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy." This is in the last days. What does God say? You and I should not have this before us. In fact, in Luke chapter 12, we see down here in verse 15, he says, "Take heed and beware," or guard yourself, "of covetousness." How could covetous get a hold of you? If you get your eyes on things and you're pursuing things and at your drive. "For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth." We find many people are just trying to get things upon things upon things. That is a mistake. In fact, it's quite a promise over in Proverbs chapter 28. The Bible again tells us that we're to hate any covetousness. Here it says, Proverbs 28, verse 16, "He that hateth covetous shall prolong his days." It has to do with long life. That means people that are going to love money, their days are going to be shortened. Now, at the same time, does this mean I can't have good things? I can't have lots of money or things? No, I can't be rich as far as in the things of this world? No, it doesn't mean that. It all comes down to an attitude of heart and what your motivation of why you do things. Because here we see a case. Joseph, the rich man of Arimathea, he was a disciple of Jesus. Notice, he was a rich man. There's no problem with being rich with things as long as things don't have you. And that's an important thing. You don't want to ever let yourself let things get a hold of you. He was a disciple of Jesus. He was a rich man. But you're going to have to put God first place and know that everything that He's given you is God that's given it to you. And you need to make Him Lord of your pocketbook so that He's in charge of whatever He tells you to do, you're willing to do it. And you're not out all for yourself. See, these are all important things to God, because God is looking upon the heart and looking on the motivation of why people do what they do. Proverbs 8:17, notice what he says. I love them that love me. Now, he generally loves everybody in the fact that he sent Jesus to die for us, to bring everybody to the place of receiving Jesus. But this doesn't mean, this is talking about a different thing. This is talking about him loving you in a way where he's going to come and manifest himself. So remember what it talks about in John chapter 14, where the one who has my words and keeps them, he is that loveth me, and talks about the Father and Jesus, how they're going to come and manifest themselves. I love them that love me. You love him, and how do you love him? If you keep his commandments, do what he says, then he's going to love you. He's going to manifest himself. And those that seek me early shall find me. Riches and honor are with me. When he's going to come and manifest himself to you, what's he going to bring? He's going to bring his riches. He's going to bring his honor. You see, if you love the Lord and you do what he wants, God is going to bless you. He's not against you having prosperity in financially and riches and things. He wants you to love him and put him first place. Don't ever get your eyes on things, possessions, money above the Lord. He says, yea, durable riches and righteousness. This is what he will bring to you. He says, my fruit's better than gold, yea, than fine gold, and my revenue, or the increase from choice silver. That means, what's important to God? The things that are important to him are the fact that you're loving him, that you're seeking after him, that you're being fruitful. How do you become fruitful? Because you're doing the things he says, walking in line with the word, and that you're on the increase, my increase, than choice silver, the increase of God. He wants us to abound and increase in all things in our life. Otherwise, it all involves relationship with God and our walk with God. I lead in the way of righteousness. Everything that God's going to do is always going to be according to righteousness in the midst of the paths of judgment. Then he says, that I may cause those that love me, that's the ones that are hearing and doing his word, to inherit substance, and I will fill their treasures. God wants to bring blessings. But it all starts with God, being right with him, walking in his ways, being fruitful, increasing in the things of God, following him, really putting him first place, not just going out there and wanting God to bless what you have, and then you keep on trying to hoard up or get as much as I can, and your eyes really are on things. That's why it's a problem for the rich. How hard it is for those who are rich to enter into the kingdom, because they end up trusting in riches. They start looking at things. Again, you do what God says, he showing the fact that you truly love him, he will cause you to inherit substance, and he will fill your treasures. That's God's blessings coming upon you. And we know in Deuteronomy chapter 28, the Bible talks about, in verse 1, it shall come to pass, if thou wilt hearken diligently unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and to do all his commandments which I command you this day, that the Lord thy God will set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon thee and overtake thee, if thou hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God. What's important to God? Not the blessings. What's important to him is whether you're following him, obeying him, walking in his ways, and then he will release his blessings to you. The key is to develop a relationship with him, to know him, to walk in his ways. That's what counts. Get your eyes off of things. Get your eyes off of all these things that would deter you away from walking in the way of the word. God wants you to hearken unto his voice. And what's going to happen? If you do that, all these blessings it talks about, it says the Lord will open unto thee his good treasure. He'll open it up to you. the heaven to give the rain into the land in season, to bless all the work of thine hand. That's having a good journey, being blessed in all the things that you do. And thou shalt lend unto many nations, and thou shalt not borrow. That means you have abundance. I mean, you have abundance to be able to lend. You don't have to borrow. That's somebody who's rich with money. You know, Abraham was rich with money and cattle and goods and all these things because he followed God and obeyed him. And God brought that forth. The Lord wants to bring blessings. But it all starts, first of all, with us having him right in our life. Deuteronomy 28:15. It shall come to pass, if thou wilt not hearken unto the voice of the Lord thy God, to observe and do all his commandments and statutes which I command you this day, all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. And there's all kinds of curses. We see in verse 20, it says, the Lord will send upon thee cursing, vexation, rebuke, and all that thou settest thine hand unto for to do. Well, that means your hand, the work of your hand isn't being blessed till you be destroyed, and how you're going to just perish, and destructive things are going to happen. That's not what God does. You know, that's not what we want to see. We want to see good things. Verse 29 says, you'll grope at noonday, the blind will grope in the dark, as the blind gropes in darkness, and thou shalt not prosper in thy ways. You'll only be oppressed, spoiled evermore, and no man shall save thee. That's a curse. That's not what God wants. He wants us to get blessed. It's not a matter of doing A, B, and C, and now blessings are going to come. Like I push the buttons, and now God's going to automatically do it. That's the way many people out there teach. Do this, give, and God's going to do such and such. And we see this all the time. Now it comes down to obeying him and following him and serving him. Look what it says in verse 47. Because thou servest not the Lord thy God with joyfulness and gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. We're supposed to serve him with joyfulness and gladness of heart for all the abundance of all things, all the things that he's given to us and provided for us in the Word. Therefore, you're going to serve thine enemies, which the Lord will send against thee in hunger and thirst and nakedness and want or lack, this means, of all things, and put a yoke of iron upon thy neck till he have destroyed thee. That's curses that come upon you. Lack is a curse. It is not what God wants. He wants us to see the great blessings, the prosperity of God occur in all areas of life. But it's all going to be in proportion to what you've done with the Lord and your walk with him. Judges chapter 18, verse 9. He said, arise, that we may go up against them. For we've seen the land, and behold, it's good. And are you still? Be not slothful to go and enter and possess the land. When you go, you shall come unto a people secure to a large land, for God hath given it into your hands, a place where there's no want of anything that's in the earth. That meant there was no lack whatsoever, no poverty, just total abundance and blessing. Well, what's this mean from a type standpoint? Because we see these things are physical types and shadows of spiritual realities that affect us today. You and I are to do what? Arise, go up against them. We've seen the land. What's the land a type of? The physical land's type of the spiritual land, which are the promises of God. Have you seen the promises of God, all the things that God has given you? It's good. Are we going to be slothful to not go and enter to possess these promises? God wants us to enter and in possess the promises. Well, how do we possess the promises? By hearing and doing his word, walking in the ways of the word of God so we can see the blessings come upon us. And he says, when you go, you're going to come into a people secure, a large land. God's given it into your hands, a place. When you come to possess the promises of God, you're going to come to that place where there's no want, no lack of anything. In other words, all the promises of God will meet every need in your life. All the things that God has, all those things pertaining to godliness, they're going to pertain to every area of need in your life, and he will meet every need. As you possess the promises, you'll be prosperous. You'll have a good journey in life. We see over in Psalms 23. Psalms 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. What's the word want mean? Lack. I'm not going to lack because the Lord's my shepherd. This is a promise. Now, this is a New Testament one as far as where the application of it is, because who's the shepherd? Jesus is the shepherd of the sheep. What are you and I? We're sheep. So the Lord, if he is truly your shepherd, which means you're a sheep, which means you're following and obeying him, you're doing everything he says, you know his voice, you hearken unto him, you're not going to want. You're not going to lack. Because the Lord is who your eye is upon. The sheep got their eyes upon the shepherd every place he goes out in the field. They do not take their eyes off Him. They follow Him. As you come to that same place and you're looking to the Lord on everything, He's your total source, you're hearing and doing His word, you're not going to want, you're not going to lack for anything. We see another principle that's important to see in Psalms 34, verse 9. O fear the Lord, ye saints, for there is no want or no lack to them that fear Him. See, what's the fear of the Lord? The fear of the Lord is beginning of knowledge. You have the fear of the Lord, you're going to be seeking after knowledge. It's the beginning of wisdom. It's going to produce the wisdom of God. By the fear of the Lord, men depart from iniquity and all the evil. The fear of the Lord is also to hate evil. I hate evil. I hate sin. I hate anything that God considers evil. I'll never walk in the ways of sin. I'm going to walk in the ways of righteousness and be obedient. And I'm going to have the fear of God before me. I'm not going to have any lack. Because when I do what God wants and He sees my heart and my obedience to Him, the blessings are going to come. Remember, when He said you hearken diligently, the blessings will come on you and overtake you. That means they're going to catch you. You couldn't even get away from them if you wanted to. Because God is going to bring His blessings. The fear of the Lord is important. In fact, we even see a scripture in Isaiah chapter 33 and verse 6. Wisdom and knowledge shall be the stability of thy times and strength of salvation. And the fear of the Lord is His treasure. That's your storehouse. That's your treasure. You walk in the fear of the Lord, it's going to unleash the storehouse, the treasure, the blessings of God, the prosperity of God is going to come forth in your life. It's not one of these send me $100 and God will send you $1,000 back kind of deal, you know, or heal your mother or whatever, all this kind of stuff that goes on. It's ridiculous. No. The fear of the Lord is your treasure. We see also and the reason why you won't lack. When you are acting on the Word of God, following the Lord, and all of a sudden you have these diverse temptations that come against you, the enemy attacking the Word, trying to stop you from seeing the blessings come forth, the promises. Know this, that the trying of your faith, it's testing your faith, trying to get you off your faith. It works patience, which is steadfastness, brings into operation steadfastness, being constant. And you let steadfastness have her perfect work, that you might be perfect, entire, complete, wanting or lacking nothing. Steadfastness on the Word of God is also another important point for you to see God's prosperity and blessing in your life. You won't have any lack. The Bible says you'll lack in nothing if you'll be steadfast, because you'll continue to do the Word. The devil won't be able to take the Word out. He won't get you to back off the Word. You continue to walk in His ways, and the Lord is going to bring the promises to pass in your life. In fact, we even see when God was leading them in Deuteronomy chapter 2 and verse 7, the Lord thy God hath blessed thee in all the works of thy hands. God does it. He knoweth thy walking through this great wilderness. These 40 years the Lord hath been with thee, and you have lacked nothing. If you got your eyes on the Lord and you're following Him, He will provide for you. You aren't going to lack anything. That is the promise of God. Another thing that we need to consider over in Proverbs chapter 28. And these are all tied into your prosperity in life. Proverbs 28:27. He that giveth unto the poor shall not lack. When someone's in need, we're not talking about just financially, whatever their need might be. They might be poor in some area spiritually or poor in some aspect. They need something. You come and you give to someone who's in need. You're not going to lack. Because you give, it's going to be given back unto you. But he that hides his eyes shall have many a curse. You just, you know, turn away and go your own way, more preoccupied with yourself. No, you're going to have many a curse. See, we got to be in God's program. We can't be on our program. We got to be in God's program if we're going to see God's prosperity and blessing. In fact, even the Bible says in Proverbs 19:17, he that hath pity upon the poor lends unto the Lord, and that which he's given will he pay him again. This is when you give finances or give out something to someone who's poor. You can't give it and think it's not coming back. It's going to come back. God is going to give that back to you again. You and I cannot allow ourselves to be covetous ever in any way. Covetousness will bring you down. We've got to be those that are going to keep our eyes on the Lord, and He's going to be our total source. In fact, We see over in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, he makes a statement. Let your conversation or your way of life, your manner, be without covetousness and be content with such things as you have. People that aren't content with what they have, covetousness is starting to work with them. I want. I want bigger and better and all these kind of things. They're driven for things that they want. He says, be content with such things as you have. In fact, that's what God's looking for. Because your life does not consist in the things you have. Philippians 4:11 says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. You need to be content in whatever state you are in, although you're still seeking for the blessings of God and the promises of God as you're following the Lord, and God will bring them. But at the same time, he doesn't want us to be those ones that are covetous. In fact, we even see from God's standpoint in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 8. Look at the statement that's made here. In fact, he says, having food and raiment, let us be therewith content. Be content, the fact that we got food and clothing. I mean, Jesus didn't have any place to lay his head. He was content with food and clothing and all the things that he had. That's all he needed. It says, godliness with contentment is great gain. What's important in life? Godliness. Having godliness is profitable for all things. With contentment is great gain. Not being all anxious and upset and all, bothered because you don't have this or have all that. No. We brought nothing into this world, and it's certain we can carry nothing out. You're not taking anything with you when you're leaving this world. But one thing for sure, you are going to be rewarded and given the true riches if you have gotten the riches, the right riches, while you are here in this life. Because there are riches that you and I are to obtain. We're not talking about the physical riches. We're talking about the things that God wants to bring forth because you've been following him. Having food and raiment, let us therewith be content. They that will be rich. Now, you lose this when you look at the King James, that will be rich. It almost sounds like it's a helper verb. But will is the main verb here. And when you look at this, this is the main verb. Those who are continually, present tense, willing to be. Because the word be here, to be rich, as you see, is an infinitive, meaning that the way you would translate that, they that will to be rich, otherwise that's where their will set. That's where they're all headed for. I want to be rich. My will is set that I've got to have these things. They fall into temptation, a snare, into foolish and hurtful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. Otherwise, that's not the way to go. Your will should be set to know God and to obey God and follow God and do everything he says. And you know what will happen? His riches will come of all types out of nowhere, and they'll come upon you. God will bring these things upon you. In fact, remember, the blessings will come on you and overtake you. For the love of money is the root of all evil. There's nothing wrong with money. God wants us to have lots of it, for being able to preach the gospel and do all the things he wants, as long as money doesn't have you. The love of money is the root of all evil. As it goes on and says, while some coveted after, they've erred from the faith. If we covet after money, we've erred from the faith. We've missed it. There's churches out there that their whole thing is prosperity, 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 prosperity. Their whole ministries are prosperity. Look at all the things that they talk about themselves. All prosperity, prosperity, prosperity. And they're talking about financial prosperity, not God's prosperity. Gimme, gimme, get, get, get. What can I do to get? They're coveting after it. They've erred from the faith. And they pierced themselves through with many sorrows. That is a mistake. Now we come down to verse 17. He says, charge them that are rich in this world that they not be high-minded. We want to be high-minded or proud. We've got to realize that most everybody in America is pretty well off. Now, a lot of people without jobs presently, they're not well off until they're recovering, maybe, if they've had lots of situations because of loss of jobs or whatever. But many people, compared to the way of the world out there in this country, are rich. I've been to Africa. I've been to 12 countries over there, or 10 countries over there. I've been places where they had no electricity. They had no running water. They had no lights. They had no nothing. And these people are just barely, they're just living off the land. Most of those places over there, there are a lot of them, are just living off the land, subsistence living. These people, that is food and raiment, that's the way they live. And they got the mud huts and all these kind of things. Here, we are so blessed in this nation. Rich in this world, charge those that they be not high-minded. Don't ever get high-minded or proud, nor trust in uncertain riches. Don't trust in those riches. You've got to get your eyes on the Lord, but in the living God. Who are we to trust in? God. At the same time, it says, He giveth us richly all things to enjoy. Is God against us having things? No. He wants you to be blessed, and He'll give you all things richly to enjoy. But don't let things have you. If they have you, then it becomes an idol in your life. And He does not want us to have any idolatry. That they do good. What's He want us to do? We're rich in this world. He wants us to go out and do good works. Do the good works of God. That's what this means. It's a form of the word good and ergon, which is the word for work. Do good works. It's not just doing good. It's the good works. That they be rich in good works. What are we supposed to be rich in from God's standpoint? Rich in good works. Doing the things that God wants us to do. You see, when you're rich in the things that God wants you to do, He's going to pour His blessings back to you, and you're going to be rich in all the things that you would have need of. He's going to pour those things into you. Ready to distribute, where you're ready to give this out. Ready to impart, as Youngs brings it out. Willing to communicate, or ready to be able to give it out, whatever might be needed, or to share with others, this can mean. This word, koinonikos. Sharing other things. Otherwise, you're ready. You're Jesus is Lord over your pocketbook. You're not just all out for me, 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 me. You're ready to do with whatever God wants you to do with your finances, and that's what He's looking for, because you got to let the Lord be Lord over you. He's not just Lord in all these areas. In this area, I'm in control. No, that's a mistake. No, Jesus is to be Lord over all the things. 1 Timothy 6:19. What are we doing if we are rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, because we've got our eyes on the Lord. Laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. That's quite a statement. You're laying up in store, where? In heaven. Because all these things that you're doing are being recorded in heaven. The good foundation against the time to come, that you might lay hold on eternal life. That tells you something. The fact that we're not laying up the right things, are we going to be able to lay hold on eternal life? What's going to happen to those people that are rich, but their ways are wrong? They're in trouble. James 1:10 says, but the rich, in that he is made low, because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away. He's made low, or he's going to just fade away. Why? Because of his evil ways, as you'll see. The sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat, but it withers the grass, the flower thereof faileth, and the grace of the fashion of it perisheth. So also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. What was his problem? His ways. He wasn't walking in God's ways. He's rich, and he had his eyes totally on money and on things and on himself and all the things he wants. That's going to stop the prosperity and the blessing of God. And you're never going to get the true riches if you're serving riches, mammon, money, instead of God. It is imperative that you make sure that you never let things, possessions, or money be an idol in your life. James chapter 2, he says here, if there come into your assembly a man with a gold ring and goodly apparel, and there come also a poor man in vile raiment, how are you going to treat him? Are you going to treat the one guy the same way the other guy? Or are you going to look to this guy that's, hey, he looks, he's richer. Boy, this guy looks good. That means money, maybe, you know? And maybe this other guy, he might be a problem or whatever. No. If you have respect to him that wears the gay clothing, talking about the brilliant clothing, the good clothing, and say unto him, sit thou here in a good place. Oh, we'll have you come up and sit up front. You know, sit you in a nice place. Please him some way. And say to the poor, stand thou here, sit here under my footstool. Go, you can sit in the corner. Well, that's wrong. That's respect of persons. God does not want that. That is evil. Are you then not partial in yourselves and have become judges of evil thoughts? We shouldn't be doing that whatsoever. Hearken, my beloved brethren, hath not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith? What are we to be rich in? We're to be rich in faith. What is one of the riches? Faith is one of the riches that God has. And heirs of the kingdom. The riches is that we're in faith, and also we're an heir of the kingdom. Because this life is a vapor. It's only a short time. This is simply training ground and proving ground for what's going to happen in the future. You got to realize that. You're to work out your own salvation in this day and age and walk the walk of Jesus. Get to know Him. Work out, overcome all the things so that you are ready to be rewarded and move on into the next life. This is proving ground here. This is the test. Just like they went through the wilderness, we're in our spiritual wilderness, and your life is a spiritual wilderness, testing to find out whether you're going to walk in the ways of the Lord or not. It's not just have a good time, bless me, build my big barns, get as much as I can, serve myself, and just kind of like God over here, you know, and yeah, I want to be saved and everything, but I'm in control of what I do. There's a problem. Notice, the rich in faith and the heirs of this kingdom, who is He promised to? He promised it to those that love Him. The ones that keep His commandments. Not just the guy that's born again. A lot of people are born again and they walk in the flesh all the time, basically. They just do whatever they want to do. They dictate everything in their life. They're not ever going to see the riches, the real riches, come forth in their life because they're not walking right. In James chapter 5, go to now, you rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. You know, if we don't put Him first place, our life will be found wanting, and we're going to see miseries. Your riches are corrupted, your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you, and eat your flesh as it were fire. You've heaped treasure together for the last days. Some people have even done that. Heap treasure. Get all my treasure for me, 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 me. I'm thinking all about me, as He says. And then He comes down to verse 5. You lived in pleasure on the earth and been wanton, living luxuriously. This word means, you've nourished your hearts as in a day of slaughter. In other words, what are you doing with all the provision that God has given you? Is it all for you to live a life luxuriously, living in pleasure, and you're not letting the Lord be really Lord over your life and putting Him first place? Is it all out for me, me, me? Is that where's our heart? Where's our motivation? Where's our mindset? That's important. Because again, remember, the riches here are nothing compared to the true riches that are going to come. The true riches. If you can't be faithful in the things now, you aren't going to get the true riches. You got to realize the big picture is where we're headed, not what's going on now. This is important. Course in your life every day to walk with the Lord, and He wants you to have a good journey and be blessed. But at the same time, the big picture is following the Lord and doing everything that He wants you to do. Acts chapter 8 and verse 20. Look at this. Peter said, "Thy money perish with thee, because thou hast thought that the gift of God may be purchased with money." This is the guy that was trying to purchase the gift of God, to be able to give people laying on of hands and so they could receive the Holy Spirit with money. Here's the principle. The principle is, can you get any gift from God by giving money or paying money or sowing money and all these kinds of things? What do we hear out there in the body of Christ? You hear it all the time. Give your money and you'll get such and such. In fact, when people offer their gifts, it's like, oh, I'll send you this Bible, this great Bible, they got it all figured out, when you send me your gift. Is that a gift? No, that's a transaction. That's doing business. Because a gift has no strings attached, does it? I'll send you the Bible, just call. Now that's great. And now if they choose to want to give you a gift at their free will, praise God. Would they do that one? Oh, they probably lose. But for $100, I'll give you this great Bible. Probably cost me about 8 or 10. I could buy it at cost when I buy it. And I know what they cost when you buy them at cost and so forth. You know, and if you don't give them the money, sorry, and they call it a gift. It's not a gift. It's a transaction. It's all deceitful. And this goes on. You know it goes on. Watch the TV, listen to the radio, listen to all this garbage. The body of Christ has got to come to the place of repentance. You cannot purchase anything of the gift of God with money. The gifts of God are free. They're freely given. Every gift, every perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights above, with whom there is no variableness or shadow of turning, the Bible says. So anybody that ever tries to say, give such and such, you've got to give such and such, and God will do such and such. Stay away from it. These people are in trouble. God wants us to deal with things. Also, if you came out of anything that was evil, like in this case, here they came out of, these guys were involved in witchcraft, Acts 19:19. Some people might have a tendency, well, I've turned away from all this. Well, now I'm going to sell all this so I can get my money back. No, you burn that stuff. It is history. You do not want to try to take anything that is ungodly and sell it to get money. Mistake. Many of them also, which use curious arts, brought their books together and burned them before all men. And they counted the price of more than 50,000 pieces of silver. That was a tremendous amount of money. Well, boy, they should have sold it, so then they'd be all blessed and prosper. God would prosper them. No, he wouldn't. It wouldn't be God at all. It'd be them. It'd be totally wrong. And they'd end up losing that, and their curses be upon them because they're using cursed things to produce money. You don't use cursed things to produce money. No profit from things of darkness. It's got to be eliminated in our life. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, here in verse 10. For when we were with you, we commanded you that if any would not work, neither should he eat. This is talking about a person who can work and needs to work apparently, but won't work. Now maybe if you don't need to work, that's not talking about you. But this is someone, maybe you're disabled and you can't work. That's not talking about. Maybe you're looking for a job and you just don't have one right now. That's not talking about you. But this is someone who can work, needs to work, and is mooching off of everybody else. Neither should he eat. God wants us to do these things because God's going to bless the work of our hands, isn't he? That's what he tells us to do. So we need to be doing the things. We can't be having that attitude. You know, some people, I've heard some people say, well, I'm just going to live by faith. Well, great. And they're living by faith is, I'm just going to not work, and I'm going to believe all these people are going to give me money so I can live. I've known people like that. And they happen to tell everybody about their needs, you know. Well, I'm living by faith, you know, and I got my house payment due here. I'm a little short, a few hundred dollars, you know. Kind of throw that little seed into their mind and stuff. Try to manipulate them, get them to give you money. That kind of stuff goes on. That's ridiculous. Get out and work. Get out and do things or whatever God, you know, in order for, you know, Paul was a tent maker. He did, so he was no burden on anybody. 1 Timothy 5:8, if any provide not for his own, especially for those of his own house, he's denied the faith and he's worse than an infidel. God wants us to work, provide for our house, as we see. So we should be doing these things. God will prosper the work of your hands and he will bless you. In Proverbs chapter 13, we see something that's important to realize. Verse 7, there is that maketh himself rich. He's done all these great things and he made himself rich. And yet he has nothing. If you did it all in your own strength, doing what you wanted to do without what God wanted you to do, and you're not doing what he wants you to do, have riches before God, you got zip. And there is that maketh himself poor, yet hath great riches. Because he was more interested in serving God and doing the things that God wanted. And so he's got great riches because he's got all the things that God wants him to do in his life. Look over in Revelation chapter 3. Revelation chapter 3, we pick up here in verse 15. Revelation 3:15. Here he says, I know thy works, but thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou were cold or hot. He says, because you're lukewarm, you're neither cold nor hot, I'm going to spew thee out of thy mouth. What was their problem? They were lukewarm. They had some of the hot and they had some of the cold, but they weren't right, and they're going to get spewed out. What was the mark about them being lukewarm? Because thou sayest, I'm rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing. This is why they were lukewarm. They were lukewarm because they had idols in their life, which was all their goods, all their possessions. and they didn't think they needed the Lord for anything. That's a mistake. That makes you lukewarm. Anytime your eyes get off the Lord, you can have some hot, but if you've got some cold, it's contaminated you, and now you're lukewarm. Instead, he says, "Knowest not that thou art wretched, you're miserable, you're poor, you're blind, and you're naked." What a mess. What's this mean? This word wretched, it's only used two times. See, it only has two uses in the New Testament down here, as it shows. The other use of this tells you what it's talking about. It's over in Romans, in chapter 7 and verse 24. In Romans 7, 24, this is where he says, "O wretched man," same word in the Greek, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" Why does he think he's wretched? Because he's got this body of death, this flesh, and he's been living by the flesh, and the flesh has been running him. Of course, the answer was, with the mind, we're going to serve the law of God, with the flesh, the law of sin. But the point is this. What is a wretched man? Somebody that's been living by the flesh. And that's what he's saying. You've been living by the flesh. That's why you're wretched, as he says back there in Revelation. That's why, in God's sight, anybody that's living by the flesh, they are wretched in the sight of the Lord, spiritually. And then the next guy, he's miserable. Why is he spiritually miserable? Well, this again, see the same thing. We have two uses again. The other use of it brings the revelation of what it's talking about. It's over in 1 Corinthians in chapter 15. And we pick up over here in verse 19, where he says, "If in this life only we have hope in Christ, we're all men most miserable." So who would be someone, it'd be miserable? Someone who is hope is totally in this life. That's their total focus. And that's what was wrong with these guys. They were so wrapped up in what they were doing in their life. In this life was their total hope, confidence, everything that they were putting it into. They were like building us for no more, us building my barns and take my ease and everything. They didn't have any idea about the fact that they were supposed to be preparing for the life to come. So someone who is spiritually miserable has their focus totally on this life instead of the things that God wants. We can't allow that. No. Our focus is the opposite. Our focus is on what God wants, not on and the life to come, as well as, of course, doing the things he wants us to do here. We see also, he says they're poor, spiritually poor. If you're poor, you're lacking. They were lacking the riches of Christ. They didn't have the riches of Christ. They had the riches of this world. They were increased with goods, but they lacked all the riches of Christ. They were also blind. Blind spiritually, these are all talking about. Spiritually blind men, they could not see spiritually. And they were naked. If you're naked, that means you're not clothed. They weren't clothed the way they were supposed to be clothed spiritually. He says, "I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire." What is tried? What's been tried in the fire? The Word of God has been tried. And so to buy it means it costs you something, because it will cost you time and effort to study the Word of God, and it'll cost you your life because you submit yourself to the Word, you put the Word of God first place, you choose to hear and do that Word and walk in it. And this Word is like gold tried in the fire, because you got to buy it of Him, you got to buy it of the Lord. You can't get it from any other source. It comes from Jesus. And what's He got? He's got the Word. "That thou mayest be rich." In other words, as you get the Word in you, and you give your life to the Word, and you are obtaining this tried in fire, you put your life in it, you are here and a doer, you commit to do the Word, then you're going to be rich in the things of God. And white raiment. What does white raiment speak of? White raiment speaks of righteousness. "That thou mayest be clothed." Otherwise, this guy wasn't clothed with clothing of righteousness and the garments of God on whatsoever. "The shame of thy nakedness do not appear." So here, this guy wasn't clothed at all. What do we see about when it talks about something that's white? In Revelation chapter 3, over here in verse 5, he said, "He that overcometh," or conquers, "and carries off the victory, the same shall be clothed in white raiment." Who's got the white raiment on? the guy who's conquered and carried off the victory over his enemies. And he's walking in the ways of the Lord. And he even says, I'll not blot out his name out of the book of life. This guy is going to be okay. Revelation 19, verse 7. Look what it says here. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come. Well, praise God, that's going to come. And who's it with? Jesus and the church, the bride. And his wife hath made herself ready. Who's that talking about? That's talking about the church. She has prepared herself and made herself actively ready. To her was granted that she should be arrayed. It's interesting that this particular word here, we talk about arrayed, is in the subjunctive mood, meaning it's conditional upon conditions being met. It wasn't automatic. And it's also in the middle voice, meaning the subject was doing the action for themselves. And when it talks about being arrayed here, it's talking about the fact that they were going to put on essentially, or clothe themselves, or throw on themselves, for their own benefit, this fine linen. And the fine linen is what? That's clean, they've been cleansed, and they've been white. They're shining brilliant because they're holy. For the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. So, the guy who's got his white raiment on, this is the guy who's been cleansed. This is the guy that's holy. This is the guy that's righteous before the Lord. He has been walking in the way of the Word. In fact, it's quite interesting. It says down in verse 14, the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, which were white and clean. That's who's going to be coming with him. All those ones that are righteous before the Lord. And that's what God wants. So we see in Revelation chapter 3, what was the problem with this guy? He's going to be spewed out because God was not his source. He was rich in things. He thought he had need of nothing. He's spiritually wretched, walking in the flesh. Spiritually miserable, eyes are on just his own life and what he's doing. Spiritually poor, because he doesn't have the riches of God. Spiritually blind, he can't see. Spiritually, he's not seeing as God sees. He's only seeing in the natural. Spiritually naked, he's not clothed with the things of God whatsoever. And he hasn't gotten the Word in him, so he'd be rich. He hasn't gotten this white raiment by conquering all the things of the enemy and walking in the ways of the Word of God and bringing forth the having on the garments of God, being clothed with righteousness. And the shame of his nakedness that would not appear. And anoint thine eyes with eye salve that thy may see. What's going to happen? The Holy Spirit is going to open the eyes of your understanding as you begin to seek after the Word, your spiritual eyes, so you'll be able to see as God sees. They couldn't see at all. They're just walking their own ways. They're walking in the natural. He says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. And notice, they even had shut him out of their life, the Lord out of their life, essentially. He says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. He's knocking on the door of their heart. And if any man hear my voice and open the door, I'll come into him and will sup with them and he with me. God was outside their life, basically. They were just living a form of godliness. That shows you that these people are in trouble because they were not rich towards God. Where's the true riches coming from? They certainly aren't coming from things. The true riches are coming from the Lord. In Colossians chapter 2, verse 3, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. It's all coming from him. He's the total source. We see over in Ephesians, in chapter 3, talks about the unsearchable. He preaches the unsearchable riches of Christ. There's so many riches that God has for us. Unsearchable. Cannot be searched out, cannot be comprehended. All the things, the riches of Christ that he has for us. He wants us to obtain all of these things. And notice even, it has nothing to do with having possessions of things. Because look at the statement he makes in Revelation 2, verse 9 to these guys. Here, this is at the church, Thyatira or Smyrna here. And he says, I know thy works and tribulation and poverty. I know you're in poverty in the natural, but thou art rich. Why were they rich? Because they had the things of God. They didn't have all these other things. And the key was they had the things of God, and that's what's important. If we're not rich in the things of God, then we're not rich at all. And we're not prospering at all from God's standpoint. We can have a whole lot of things, possessions, money, all these things, and be totally spiritually destitute like these other guys. That's why God's prosperity is to bring forth the real riches unto you. Romans 2, verse 4. Or despise thou the riches of his goodness and forbearance and longsuffering, knowing that the Lord, the goodness of God leads you to repentance. God's riches are his goodness, his forbearance, his longsuffering being manifested to you to bring you to the place of repentance in your life. We see in Romans 9, over here in verse 23, that he might make known the riches of his glory on the vessels of mercy, which he had afore prepared into glory. The riches of his glory, that's the manifest presence of God. God's riches include the manifest presence of God coming into your life. And that's what he wants to bring forth. He wants you to be carrying the presence of God. Romans 11, verse 12. Now if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? The riches. The riches are the things that God wants to bring into our life to bring us into relationship with him and walk in his ways. And that's what he has for us. That's the effects of the gospel to us will bring the riches of Christ to us. We see in verse 33, oh, the depths of the riches, both of wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. The more that you have knowledge and wisdom and you know the ways of God, the more that you're getting the riches of God. And you're going to be rewarded for having the riches of God in the life to come. Because that's what counts. Because the rewards come because of all the things. When everything's going to be tried by fire, only the things that are going to stand are you going to be rewarded for. All the things that are hay, wood, and stubble or burn up, there's no rewards for those. No riches, no blessings for those whatsoever. 1 Chronicles 1, verse 4. I thank my God always on your behalf for the grace is given me by Jesus Christ, that in everything you are enriched by him in all utterance and in all knowledge. Notice what he says. You're enriched or made rich by him in all utterance and in all knowledge, even as the testimony of Christ was confirmed in you. In other words, what's the riches of Christ? It's the utterance, the word, the speech that you have, because you're giving testimony and through the knowledge and the testimony of Christ confirmed in you. Otherwise, the work of God, and you're preaching it, you're declaring it, it's shown forth, you're speaking it forth. That's important to God. You're not to be a closet Christian. You're to be one who is carrying out the speaking of the word of God and preaching the gospel, and it's to be shown in your life. Also, what else is God going to take note of as real riches in your life? 2 Chronicles, Corinthians chapter 6, verse 4. In all things, approving ourselves the ministers of God, in much patience, afflictions, necessities, distresses, he talks about, all these different things. Then he comes down in verse 10. He says, a sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. Why? Because of the situations that he had to deal with people and so forth. As poor, financially, yet making many rich. Oh, he's making many rich because he's bringing the gospel to them. He's bringing them out of spiritual poverty into spiritual richness. That's the ball game. We want us to have the spiritual riches of Christ as having nothing and yet possessing all things. Because what do we want to possess? We want to possess the things of God. That is what God is wanting to bring forth in your life so you can be prosperous and blessed. 2 Corinthians 9, down here in verse 10, he talks about how the minister's seed to the sower, ministers bread for your food, multiply your seed sown, increases the fruits of your righteousness, being enriched in everything to all bountifulness. Otherwise, you're being enriched. You're being made rich spiritually in everything to all bountifulness, which causes through us the thanksgiving to God because of you giving out and helping to meet other people's needs. We see over in Ephesians chapter 1 when it talks about these riches, how we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sin, according to the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace. God's grace is his riches coming to you, his favor to bring forth the good things that he wants in your life. We see in the prayer over at Ephesians 1:18, the eyes of your understanding being opened. You know what's the hope of the calling and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. The riches of the glory of his inheritance. That's the glory of God, which manifests his inheritance coming forth in our life. Another thing, Ephesians 2:4, God who is rich in mercy, the mercy of God. It shows the riches. You come and take hold of his mercy, and you show mercy everywhere you go. We see in Ephesians chapter 3, these are the riches that he speaks of that are important. He's praying here that he would grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with might by his spirit in the inner man. That's why God wants you to get empowered on the inside of you, full of power and strength and might. This is dunamis, power, and this is the word manifested power, form of this word kratos. He wants you to be manifesting power with power that's been resident within you. The riches of his glory, the manifest presence of God will come out of you as you start putting forth the power of God that's been resident with you, praying and releasing it out of you. God's taking notice of that. Those are spiritual riches that are established in you. Philippians 4, we know in the area of even your needs. He says, Philippians 4:19, my God shall supply all your need according to what? His riches in glory by Christ Jesus. God's riches in glory is releasing and bringing forth the meeting of all of your need in your life. Praise God. He wants us to be blessed. We see in Colossians 2, verse 2. So that would include financial things as well. Their heart might be comforted, being knit together in love unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and the Father and of Christ. The more that you gain the understanding, and the word acknowledgement is this really the word epignosis, which means precise and correct knowledge. As you come to the full assurance of understanding and precise, correct knowledge of the mystery, that also is bringing the riches of God into you. And you're going to be rewarded according to these things that are important. We're not talking about natural riches. We're talking about spiritual riches that God is bringing unto you. That's why the Word is essential. All these people that are not putting the Word and getting in the Word, they're out there just playing church. They're not going to hardly have anything when they get done with their days if they haven't got the Word in them. Colossians 3:16, let the Word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom. The more the Word's dwelling in you in all wisdom, the more the riches of Christ is coming into you. Hebrews chapter 11, we see over in verse 26. He says, this is talking here about Moses says he was choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season in verse 25 of Hebrews 11, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. He didn't care about the treasures in Egypt. He wanted the riches of Christ. He wanted the riches of what God wanted by following the Lord. Whenever you follow the Lord, even if you're persecuted, you're going to still rejoice. Your reward is going to be great in heaven, remember? Because you're really stacking up riches. You're laying up riches in heaven for yourself. And you are going to be blessed in the life to come. See, God's riches and prosperity, physical things are just minor. All these things are just minor compared to him. What really counts is, are we rich towards God? What kind of a life are we living? The end of our days, he's going to take a good look at us. James 2:5, he says, has not God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith? He wants you rich in faith. You want your faith developed. You want your faith to grow strong. The Bible says your faith will grow exceedingly. He wants you to have faith in all areas of the Word. As you hear the Word and you're walking in the Word and your faith has grown strong and increased, that is riches of God. And heirs of the kingdom, he's promised to those that love him. Praise God. We also see the fact that if you're going to see the riches of God, you're going to have to be diligent in everything that you do. Don't do things half-heartedly. We've already seen scriptures where you do everything with all your heart and all your soul in the previous messages. Look what it says. The hand of the diligent makes rich. That's not only true in the natural, but remember, this is spiritual revelation that he's given us. The hand of the diligent. You're diligent in everything you do. Diligent in studying, diligent in witnessing, diligent in prayer, diligent in doing the things that God wants, diligent in ministering to other people, as well as diligent in all the works you do, all the work of your hand, everything you do. Don't ever do things half-heartedly. Always do things with great diligence. And you start doing these things, you're going to see great blessings come forth. Proverbs 22:4, humility and the fear of the Lord are what? It's going to produce riches, honor, and life. That's what will happen to us in the life to come. And we even see over in Proverbs 14, verse 24, he says, the crown of the wise is their riches. The people that are wise, their crown is all their riches. What's the riches? That's the crown you're going to get, because it's going to be the blessing that's going to come. Of the wise is their riches. See, you and I are going to get a crown, remember. Because what are we doing here? Are we just walking and going along here, you know, just going to make it to heaven and, you know, we'll be okay. We'll just follow the Lord, be a good Christian, and do whatever we feel like we want to do. No, we're running a race. We're seeking after something. 1 Corinthians 9:24 says, know you not that they which run in a race run all, but one receives the prize, so run that you may obtain. We're running this race in this life to obtain. What are we trying to get? Every man that strives to the mastery, remember, that means you're going to contend with the adversaries. You've got to conquer the enemy. He's going to be temperate in all things. You're keeping this body under. You're not about to let this body run you. Now, they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but what are we after? An incorruptible crown. The incorruptible crown that we're going to be given because of the fact that we've been following the Lord and the blessings are going to come. In fact, Paul, he understands this. He's got this eyes on this. Philippians 3:13, he says, hey, I count not myself to have apprehended, or it means to have laid hold upon everything. This one thing I do, I'm forgetting the things that are behind. Forget all that stuff. I'm reaching forth into the things that are before. I'm headed towards the mark. What am I pressing for? I am pressing, or this means running after. I'm running after towards the mark for the prize, the award, the heavenly reward of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. It's not just holding on until Jesus comes and I'm going to make it. I got my ticket to heaven and praise God, I'll make it. No, that is so far away from what God has. He wants you to run this race. Praise God. In fact, we even see a few more scriptures before we close about this crown that we're going to see. 1 Thessalonians 2:19, he says, what's our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? We got a crown of rejoicing. Are not even you in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ at his coming, which is the parousia, which is the second coming of Jesus? In other words, your crown of rejoicing is the fact that you're going to be with Jesus. That's your hope. Your hope is all the fact that you're going to be with Jesus at his second coming when he comes back. Then we see over in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 8, he makes this statement. He says, henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give me at that day. And not to me only, but to all them that love his appearing. Who's going to love his appearing? All the ones that are right. Who's going to hate his appearing? All the ones that aren't right, because they know they're going to be in trouble. A crown of righteousness. We see another thing about crown in James 1:12. Blessed is the man that endures temptation, for when he's tried, or this means literally, because it's not a good translation here, there's ginomai and dokimos. Dokimos means accepted or having been approved. Ginomai means become, if you see down below here. So what this is literally saying is because becoming approved or accepted, which is the way it should be translated correctly in the Greek, man that endures temptation because becoming approved, because he's passed the test, he didn't fall for him, he's going to receive, take hold of lambano, the crown of life. That's right. That the Lord's promised to them that love him. Who gets it? The ones that love him. The ones that are walking the walk. Not everybody out there. And people haven't even paid attention to all these things. It's amazing. People haven't even looked at these scriptures. In fact, the pastors and those people that are teaching the word, they got to get themselves together on what they're to do. When the chief shepherd shall appear, they can receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away, because they have been obedient to do what God wants them to do. And if they haven't been a good shepherd and they haven't been feeding the word of God and doing all the things they should, they're not going to get the crown of glory that fades away. In fact, there's quite a statement made. You say, well, I know I'm going to get this crown. Nobody can take it away from me. Well, that's not what the Bible says. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast that thou hast, that no man, nobody, nothing, take thy crown. You could have it, and then you could lose it. It could be taken away from you. Lambano means to take away. That crown could be taken away. And it's in the subjunctive mood, which means if the conditions such are met such. If you don't hold fast the things you have, you could lose what you have. It could be taken away. See, people that think that, oh, everything's going to be fine, they don't know what they're talking about. And they're all focused on prosperity. Give me money, give me things, give me all these things. That's not the whole picture. God will bring forth these great blessings upon us, but He wants us to have the real focus. What is God's prosperity? It's to have a good journey as you're walking this walk, getting to know the Lord, developing a personal, intimate fellowship with Him, working out your salvation, conquering the enemy, triumphing over everything, making sure that you don't walk by this flesh ever, making sure you walk in the fear of the Lord, you're putting His word first place, you're hearing and doing His word, you're clothing your garments, getting clothed with righteousness, your eyes are open, you're not walking in the flesh, you know, and being one of those guys that's like the guys that are going to be spewed out of his mouth. No. The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich, and he adds no sorrow with it. When God's blessing comes upon you, that's his riches coming to you because you have been made, you had had the riches of God established in you. God wants us to be rich towards God. Real prosperity is riches across the board coming from God because we have put him first place in our life and God's blessings are going to come forth in our life. He wants us to be financially blessed and we're going to be talking about that. But certainly we see that all this prosperity is all subject to our soul prospering. So all these principles we've given in today as well as the last two messages are all things that have to come in line in our soul. So we come in line with the Word. Then we come in line with the Word. Now we're focused right with God, walking in His ways, doing all the things He says, not yielding to anything that would bring destruction, eyes off of the things of this world, not walking in my own ways, all these things we talked about. And then you're going to see the blessings are going to come on you and overtake you. And you're going to be rewarded in the life to come because you're going to get the crown. Because we're running for the incorruptible crown. We're not trying to just make it here. We're going for the incorruptible crown. We want to know the Word inside and out. We want to know this Word. We're going to do this Word. We're going to walk in it. This Word is going to absolutely establish you in all the things of God that are going to prepare you for the life to come. And unfortunately, most of the church out there has no earthly idea of this. All they think about is prosperity, give me money, 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 and riches is, you know, all these things. Because that's what the world does. But it's totally wrong. God wants us to prosper, and it will happen in your life. You'll have a good journey as your soul prospers, putting God first place in your life. Say this with me. Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for your covenant of prosperity and all the riches, the treasures, the blessings that you have for me. I thank you. I'm going to lay up treasures in heaven, not on this earth. Where my heart is where my treasure is. I thank you that I will be faithful with another man's riches or possessions, so I'll be given the true riches. I'm serving God, not money, not possessions, not things. And I serve God, I'm going to get the true riches. I will never be covetous. I will not give place to any sin that would cause me not to be content. I will be content in whatever situation I'm in. My eyes are focused on the Lord, and I am going to have godliness with contentment, which is great gain. And I thank you that I'm going to be rich in the things of God. I will not trust in earthly riches, but I will trust in the living God. And I thank you that you do give me richly all things to enjoy. And I thank you for all your blessings that will come upon me in possessions and in things. But it's as I walk in line with your word, I will be hearkening diligently unto your voice. And I will be doing what you tell me to do. Because as I conquer the enemy and overcome and walk in the ways of the word and have the treasures of wisdom and knowledge and seek after the riches of Christ in all aspects of the word, I'm going to be accumulating riches. I have treasures laid up that I'm going to see manifest in rewards that are going to come forth in the life to come. And I will receive the crown because I'm running the race to get the incorruptible crown. I'm going to get a crown of righteousness. I'm going to have a crown of rejoicing. I'm going to have the incorruptible crown. And I'm going after the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus, because I will have conquered temptation and been approved and accepted. I'm going to get the crown of life. I understand that if I don't hold fast, that my crown could be taken from me. But I'm going to walk in the ways of the Lord. And I thank you that as I hearken diligently unto your voice and your blessings come on me, overtaking me, the blessing of the Lord makes me rich in the things of God. And I thank you that I'm going to be rich in every aspect of life because my eyes are totally on you. I totally live unto you. Thank you for bringing forth your total prosperity and blessing and riches in my life as I'm a hearer and a doer of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. The riches of Christ, the treasures, they're all for us. And it's all going to come in the life to come. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, we're going to continue, and we're going to begin to talk about things that are dealing with finances coming up on Sunday. But these first three have been very important, because if we don't have all these straight, everything else is all focused on self. These last three messages all are important. You bring yourself in line with all these, you're on the road to seeing God's blessings and his riches and his treasures and his prosperity in all aspect of your life. Praise God. And I guarantee you do that, God will meet every need. He will meet every need in your life, and he'll pour out blessings upon you. And you put him first place, he'll do that. I had it happen to me. I'll just tell you this. As I've sought to do this and never sought to try to promote myself in ministry or do anything, just sought to just go forth and do the things that God wanted me to do. And I had desire to want to go and do things of missionary work. Well, I had a person that God moved upon that gave a large amount of money, over six figures, to me. And I took that money and I gave it to the ministry. I could have, he purposed, the person wanted it. They just put it, God put it in their heart, they wanted to give it to us. And the reason was because they wanted us to be blessed, because they saw our work. But I said, I want this for the riches of Christ. I want this for the ministry of the Lord. I don't want it for myself. I took the whole thing, the whole works, and put it into the ministry. And that's how I was able to go to Africa 12 times, because I didn't have the money to do it, because it cost thousands of dollars every time, $6,000, $7,000, $8,000 a crack when you went over there, because you had to pay everything over there. But it was able to use that, and also to, you know, preach the gospel on a few more radio stations and reach people. And praise God. It's a great blessing and the great things that God has done. So you put God first, and who knows, God might come along and just do that. I mean, it was unexpected, never thought that would ever happen, you know. But God, that was a blessing, just came on me and overtake me. And I'll never forget that. That gave me an opportunity to go and to be able to minister to all those people. And it's God just done great things, and it's continuing to happen in those nations today. Put God first Watch what he does in your life. He might come along and just, who knows what he might do. But put him first, and always don't ever let anything get to you, go to your head and think what I want, I want, I want. You always find out what God wants. You do always do what God wants, and you're going to be blessed, and you're going to be putting treasure up there in heaven, and you're going to be rewarded in the life to come. Father, thank you for all you brought forth. We're going to be hearers and doers of your word. Thank you for the riches of Christ established in every single one of us. So when our days are done, we're going to hear a good report. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of the Lord. And we're going to see the riches and the blessings and the rewards poured out upon us because we have done what you said. Thank you for all that you're accomplishing as we do your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. If you need prayer, I invite you to come forward. And we went over about 15 or 20 minutes, but sorry, just kind of went that way. God bless. You're dismissed. If you need to go, do you have a question or something?